When people talk about night vision devices, they most often mean those reliant on image intensifier technology. These image intensifiers are tubes that receive and intensify ambient light by a significant factor. And inside those tubes is an extremely special glass plate, produced with a number of semiconductor-ish techniques. In this video, a brief look at the creation and evolution of night vision goggles. The idea of something that enhances the minimal light found in the darkness has been thought about since at least the 1700s, when the Russian polymath Mikhail Lomonosov proposed an optical device for seeing things in the dark. But the technologies to actually make the idea practical did not begin to emerge until the 1920s. That decade, TV manufacturers built the first image intensifiers to increase the sensitivity of their experimental TV tubes. These early image tubes were very simple. First, you had a photocathode, a type of electron source that turns photons into electrons via the photoelectric effect. Those electrons would then be accelerated across a vacuum towards a TV-like screen. Painted on that screen's insides are phosphors that glow when impacted by said electrons. It really is like how those old cathode ray tube TVs used to work. The resulting image would then be magnified by the goggles' eyepiece. Nowadays, we tint the image green, not just because it looks cool, but because it is the color in which human eyes can most easily distinguish shades. The major issues with these pioneer tubes were the phosphors on the screen and the photocathode itself, the latter being made from silver oxygen cesium, which did not emit that many electrons, giving us bad quote-unquote gain, or light enhancement. To get around this, engineers coupled two tubes back to back. This created a cascading effect that gave them the name cascading image tubes, or image intensifiers. The image did come out upside down thanks to optics, but who cares? During World War II, the Army Corps of Engineers Engineer R&D Laboratory hired Oscar Cleaver, a low-light specialist out of Westinghouse. Cleaver's team then led the development of several near-infrared, or NIR, tools. Near-infrared light refers to infrared light just beyond that of visible light, meaning a wavelength of about 0.7 to 1.5 micrometers. It is primarily emitted by the sun. These binoculars slash goggles were big and heavy, and so had to be made in a Z-shaped format for balance reasons. Even so, they were still too heavy to be useful on the battlefield. So instead, World War II night vision devices were tank periscopes, driver aids, and weapons sights. Both sides also produced NIR sniper scopes for operating at night, and they required a heavy battery backpack. However, the conversion tubes' efficiencies for all these early devices were too low, so in the dark, the battlefield still had to be illuminated with NIR floodlights. This was impractical. The enemy can see with the floodlights too, so Gen Zero devices like these were not adopted at scale. After World War II, there was the Korean War. In 1950, Communist China entered the fighting and successfully pushed back the American-led United Nations forces. Much of that military success came after dark, creating the impetus for night vision technology. During World War II, AEG scientists built an experimental cascade image intensifier for the German military. It did not help them win that war. But later in 1953, John Johnson in the US Army identified it as having a lot of potential for a night vision device, so they contracted RCA to build a two-stage intensifier tube for detecting NIR. The RCA guys had manufacturing issues with this infrared photocathode, so with the Army's permission, they swapped it for another photocathode made from a four-way combo of sodium, potassium, antimony, and cesium that had been recently invented the prior year by an RCA scientist. In 1957, they tested this new configuration and found that it worked far better than expected. Moreover, it was passive, needing only the light of the moon and the stars. The Army immediately changed the objective from a better NIR machine to image intensification. As the war in Vietnam ramped up during the early 1960s, the American military again needed night vision capabilities. However, infrared technologies were then still too bulky for deployment, so they turned to image intensifiers. In 1964, this first generation of image intensifiers hit the battlefield with the Starlight rifle-mounted scope. The Starlight scope, the name refers to several types of scopes, had three stages coupled back to back to back using fiber optics, each stage intensifying the light of the stage before. The total light amplification was about 70 times. It was small, portable, and only needed the light from the stars to operate. Ironically enough, however, foot soldiers in Vietnam used them more for scanning the landscape looking for the enemy rather than actual shooting. This was because standard combat procedure called for immediate massive fire after IDing a target. The barrage would create so much light to create a flare effect, flooding the image and making it look hazy. These first generation devices also suffered a signal to noise problem. When the light was low, as little as a quarter moon, the image got super grainy, making it hard to discern details. For this reason, most soldiers preferred to use them with searchlights. First generation systems are still being sold today. They're relatively cheap and perform quite well for ordinary folks, but they're no longer used in the military. The goal with the next generation of image intensifiers was to make the system smaller. Key to this was the channel image intensifier, a variant of the general electron multiplier first proposed in the 1930s by P.T. Farnsworth, but not made in reality until the 1950s by the Soviets and Americans. The vacuum tube-like channel is lined on the inside with charged metal electrodes. An electron entering the channel is accelerated through the channel, bouncing off those electrodes. With every bounce, the electrodes release secondary electrons, amplifying their number while confining the whole stream within a tight tube. The idea thus was to put together a whole bunch of them at very tight volumes. This gives you a microchannel plate, or MCP, an extraordinarily manufactured plate with thousands or even millions of these microchannels, each just a few micrometers wide. The microchannel plate dramatically improved the device's usefulness. Previously, first-generation items required light from either the moon or the stars. Now it was possible to see even in overcast skies and moonless nights. The plate also made the system small, light, and rugged enough for mounting onto a helmet. The catch is that the device's image resolution, as in how much clarity and detail the intensifier's image can reproduce, directly depends on how many channels there are and how tightly bunched they are, like pixels on a screen. So how do you make it? Can it even be done? John Johnson wondered if it was possible to etch many channels into a glass plate at enough volume and density to maintain some image resolution. So he asked a colleague to try, who used acid etching to show that it was indeed possible. So yeah, it can be done, but doing it at scale was a different matter. Various methods had been tried before. Mullard Research Labs in London had a metal core process. First, you coat wire with molten glass like chocolate around a strawberry, and then tightly wind them together around a drum like cotton candy. After the glass cools, you can then cut out a block from this lump, which you then slice wafers out of like a ham. We then use an acid to dissolve the metal wires. Presto, an MCP. It worked, but spooling the molten glass-covered wires was hard and got to be too expensive. Another idea was to use photolithography to draw out these very fine parallel grooves on thin glass plates. We then etch those grooves into said plates, again with an acid. We then fuse together a stack of these grooved plates, which kind of remind me of Kit Kat bars or lasagna sheets, and finally then slice the finished MCP off of it like a fine cheese. The photolithography part of this worked fine. The larger issue was that etch processes had not yet evolved to achieve the necessary precision. So in the end, what worked best, and most economically, was the so-called double draw method, a method conceptually similar to that which produces optic fiber. As the name says, it consists of two draws. In the first draw, you take a glass column, it can be hollow or with something that can be etched away later, and heat it at the bottom. That bottom stretches or draws down like honey. As it draws, it shrinks to about a millimeter wide while maintaining its structure. We then cut lengths of these glass threads like spaghetti and bundle them together. We then do the second draw, heating the bottom of the bundle and gently pulling it down like as before. The bundled threads shrink until each thread is now maybe a few dozen microns wide. The bundle is then cut into slices like a salami. We then polish the plate's surface like how we do with brown rice to get white rice. We finally finish by coating the microchannels' insides with metal using what is now called physical vapor deposition. Due to these initial manufacturing challenges, early second generation night vision goggles lacked enough microchannels in the plate, causing relatively poor image resolution compared to the prior generation of night vision equipment. Today, microchannel plates have spread out of the military and into things like particle detectors and medical imaging. Such plates are different from those for night vision, a bit bigger, and may be coupled with larger power supplies, CCDs, or more. And in recent years, people are thinking about replacing the traditional lead glass for silicon. They can thus take advantage of advanced semiconductor methods like reactive ion etching, used to produce through-silicon vias for advanced packaging to make the microchannels. The third generation of image intensifiers introduced a new type of photocathode. Made from gallium arsenide, these new photocathodes are fragile and more sensitive to visible light. With 80,000 times amplification, users get more detail, contrast, and a longer range of 360 meters or so. These special photocathodes also let us see into some near-infrared bands like shortwave infrared. One big issue with the gallium arsenide photocathodes, however, was that they are highly reactive with the microchannels. Electrons flow backwards into the photocathode, damaging it, a phenomenon known as ion poisoning. So people applied a thin metal oxide coating, called an ion barrier film, to the input side of the MCP. The Japanese manufacturer Hamamatsu uses aluminium. The barrier extends the photocathode's working life at the cost of some performance. These third-generation image intensifiers were used during Operation Desert Storm in Iraq. Night vision goggles worn by ground troops and helicopter pilots had a big impact on the battlefield. In 2001, the US government redefined the meaning of generations. So since then, they don't really call anything a fourth-generation night vision system. A few private companies do have their own 3+ or fourth-generation nomenclature. Such devices have that name because they remove the ion barrier, usually by coating the MCP's surface with some material using an advanced semiconductor process called atomic layer deposition. Image intensifiers work quite well. They're small, light, easy to mount, and use little power. But there is one major shortcoming. They still require us to have some light around, even if it needs less than it used to. And image intensifiers also do not particularly do much in identifying potential targets. This might be where thermal imagers can contribute. The 1970s first saw the introduction of far-infrared detectors. Unlike the aforementioned near-infrared light, far-infrared light has a lower frequency and longer wavelength. It's the type radiation emitted by warm objects, radiant energy without the need of an exterior light source. There are two types of these, photon detectors and thermal detectors. Photon detectors use doped semiconductor materials and the electrons they emit via the photoelectric effect. Thermal detectors, on the other hand, rely on tracking and measuring changes in a special material absorbing infrared radiation via the thermal effect. As thermal and image intensifier-based night vision technology progressed, it made a lot of sense to combine them. For example, thermals cannot ID light sources or trees, and they struggle to see through glass windows. Thermal images also suffer from a lower contrast and resolution than what you can get with image intensifiers. Image intensifiers, on the other hand, cannot see and emphasize heat sources like thermal imagers can. They also have trouble with fog, smoke, and atmospheric conditions. For this reason, there makes a lot of sense to fuse the two together. Image fusion first began in the mid-1990s and early 2000s with optical fusion methods. This is where an image from the intensifier is optically overlaid with an image from the thermal sensor. These optically fused night vision devices first began field testing in 2003. They worked well enough to create enhanced night vision goggles like the ANPSQ-20. Despite it being heavier than its predecessors, the soldier has to wear a battery pack on their hip. The military started using them in Afghanistan and Iraq in 2008. These goggles have a lot of advantages, but one slight disadvantage is that they can cost as much as $18,000 each, about the price of a well-reviewed BYD EV. Down the line, the goal would be to move to some form of digital fusion, digitally combining two images from two or more spectrum wavebands at a pixel level, kind of like how your modern smartphones computationally merge together multiple frames from a CMOS image sensor to obtain a better overall image. Going digital gives you the flexibility to maybe combine multiple wavebands, apply some wicked visual AI to clean up or improve the image, and even share images through the network. However, there are still issues to overcome, most notably with latency and slow update rates that cause the screen to lag reality. This mismatch between various sensory inputs, most noticeable when someone has to turn around quickly, can make people feel like that they are floating, leading to eye strain, headaches, and car sickness. Before we close, I want to thank viewer of the channel, Dan O, for suggesting this topic. He previously suggested the YKK video as well. I enjoyed studying the history of these devices and was surprised to learn just how much analog technology is still in there, but it makes sense. These goggles have to be reliable, light, and easy to operate even under stressful circumstances. Right now, we have an ongoing flowering of the VR and AR headset markets. Items like the Apple Vision Pro offer video pass-through with unprecedented speed. I wonder if those technologies can help solve the digital overlay lag issue. Even so, night vision goggles based on image intensifiers and the tubes and plates inside them are definitely not going away anytime soon. Alright everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, sign up for the Patreon, and I'll see you guys next time.